bones will sing, great are you, Lord. Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? It's a great day. Amen. Aren't you glad for another day that God has given us? We're going to stand together if you're here in the house today. If you're online, we welcome you as well. Thank you for being here with us. And we're going to worship our God. We're going to celebrate the fact that we are cleansed by the blood of our Savior. Amen. Hallelujah.
Jesus, for the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace in the south? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest in His moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb, are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom comes, robe me white, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the night bright? Oh, in the blood of the Lamb, are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin. Let me wash in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Nothing else could help. Love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deep He stayed with me, sinking to rise no more. But the Master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, when nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart, all my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I cling. did his plans and presence live. Ever his praise to sing.
Yes.
Love so mighty and so true. There is my soul's best song. Faithful, loving service to him. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saved. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Billows his will obey. He, your Savior, wants to hear me say today.
For that today, that God's love has lifted us. He's lifted us out of the pit, the Bible says. You know, when we're living our lives without him, we might as well be in a pit. We might as well be in a place where there's no light, where there's no hope, where there's no help. Without Jesus, we are helpless and we are hopeless. But God's love has made a way for us to say hallelujah, right? Amen. He is a good, good God, and we continue, Lord, to worship you and to serve you and to lift up your name because you're worthy today. 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10 say, by this the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. There's hope today. In this love, the Bible says, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. What a blessing, what a truth that is today. Psalm 145 says, I will extol you, O my God, O King. I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and highly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. That's why we raise our voices today, because he's a great and awesome God, and he's lifted us, and his love has poured out upon us. And because of that, we will continue to sing his praise. He is worthy. Hallelujah.
Will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Oh, my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God is never late, is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will. I choose to praise, glorify the name of all days. Nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all days. Nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will.
How many of you are glad we serve a God that doesn't fail? Amen. He won't fail. He's never failed us. And how many know He will never fail us? I want to read from Romans chapter 8. As I was praying this morning, this verse was on my heart. The Lord just dropped this passage in my heart. So I got my Bible and I began to read it. And it really encouraged me. And I feel like I'm supposed to read it this morning here because I believe it will encourage you. And it goes right along with what we're singing here. And it's Romans beginning with 8, verse 31. It says, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Everybody say, God is for me. Now, I want you to think about that for just a moment. Think about what that means. If someone is for you, we would kind of say it this way. If someone's for me, they're in my corner. Right? They're there for me. They support me. They help me. They're my biggest fan. Anything that I need. When you're for somebody, that's what that means. So when Paul says, if God is for us, and He is, that's what he's saying, God's for us, then who can be against us? The enemy can try to come against us, but he can't defeat us. Why? Because God's for us. Amen. How many of you have an older brother or sister? You have an older sibling, right? And some of you that have an older sibling, maybe you remember in school, was there ever a time where you got picked on and your older sibling stepped in and defended you and said, now listen, that's my younger brother. You won't mess with them again. Understand? And they were for you. Or any time, if you ever had somebody defend you or be there, let me tell you something. Greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world. As born again believers, the Spirit of God lives on the inside of us. If God is for us, who could be against us? And then he says this, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things. Did you hear what I just said? God who's for us, He graciously, out of His grace, there's nothing He won't give us that we need. He graciously gives us all things. And then if you can read that, all those verses, but if you jump down to verse 37, actually look at verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, none of those things will separate us from the love of Christ. Verse 37. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. How many of you know God is for us? Through Him, we are more than a conqueror. I'm talking to somebody right now. Maybe you're here. Those watching online, I want you to know, in Christ, you are more than a conqueror. You're more than a conqueror. So we're going to pray. We're going to pray. And as we pray, I want you right now, if there's a need in your life, I want you to give it to God. Before service, we prayed for individuals who are feeling defeated, who are feeling discouraged, who are depressed, who are battling anxiety or fear. We prayed for those that have got weighed down just with discouragement maybe right now. And we prayed that God would bring a great awareness today to people's hearts that He's for us. God is for us. A greater awareness that we're more than conquerors. So I want us to pray right now. Can we all across this sanctuary, those that are watching online, pray with us. We want to pray right now. If there's a need in your life, give it to God. If there's something your family's walking through, give it to God. We have victory today in Jesus Christ. And so by faith, let's call on Him right now. Can we? Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we pray. We pray, God, today we call upon You, the One with whom all things are possible. Father, we bless You today. Father, we honor You and we love You today. And we thank You. And I pray, God, right now in Jesus' name, that You would touch Your people. Touch each and every single one. As folks are calling on You right now, we thank You for helping us. We thank You for being there for us. God, thank You that You are for us. You're not against us. And we thank You for that. And so, Lord, by faith, we give You every need, every situation. And we thank You, God, that You help us. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I pray, we come into agreement and pray for Patrick and his family today. Lord, upon the passing of his sister-in-law just yesterday. Father, we pray for this family. And pray, God, that You would wrap Your arms of love around each of them. And that You would minister to them in a mighty, mighty way. In Jesus' name. May the peace of God, may the comfort of God rest upon them in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, let's go ahead and thank God now, can we? Can we thank Him for hearing our cry? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, we thank You today. We love You today. Father, we give You praise. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Hallelujah. You can be seated this morning. Turn to somebody. Tell them hi. Tell them you're glad to see them. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. We want to say welcome. Welcome to you this morning. We're so glad that you are here and so glad that you are in the house of God this morning. How many of you are glad to be in church? Amen? Hallelujah. And we want to welcome all of our audience that's watching online, wherever you may be. Thank you so much for tuning in today. We just want to say welcome, welcome, welcome. It's good to see you. It's good to see everyone here. Hey, just a couple of things real quickly. When you came in this morning, you should have received the new bulletin for the month of August, which August comes in this week. And can you believe we're already to the month of August? Can you believe that? And believe it or not, it's here. And so so we want to encourage you. Make sure if you did not, on your way out, make sure you get a bulletin for the month of August. There's some important information in there. One thing that's not in there that I was asked to share is we are still in need of some individuals that would be willing to help us with our live stream. And so we're still expanding those. We're getting ready to add a second camera and some different things that we're doing. And we need the personnel. And we have some folks that have stepped up and say, hey, we want to help, but we don't want them to have to do it every single Sunday so that they're not always tied to doing that. So if you would have an interest in learning how to run a computer, how to run a camera, you say, hey, I'm teachable. Then would you see my son Tyler today? Very important. See him today and say, hey, I'm willing. And you can get more details from him. He'll talk to you about training and teaching you and all of those sorts of things. But see him today before you leave. If you say, hey, I'm willing to at least learn more about that. And that would be great, great. We appreciate your help on that. And we thank you so, so much. At this time, I have a presentation I want to make. Jeremy, can you give me that microphone right there, if you would, please? And I did not tell this person I was going to do this, but I am going to ask Steve Morris to join me up here, if you would, please. He's thinking, what in the world did I do? Come right up here, sir, would you? Just come right up here. And last Sunday, we had our annual business meeting, and many of you were here for that. And I wanted to take an opportunity this morning publicly in front of everybody just to make a couple of comments. Steve just finished a three-year term serving on our church board, and his term has expired. And so he comes off the board. And so I want to just publicly here on this morning just to show my appreciation and to let Steve know we appreciate the time you serve in these past 3 years, and it doesn't mean you're done serving in the church, you know, but this in this capacity for right now, we want to say thank you so much for serving and for helping and leading, and the church board, I appreciate them so much. We meet at least on a monthly basis. They get bugged by me with calls and emails different times as we have decisions we have to make. And I say, hey, I need your help. What should we do here? And just seeking their counsel and wisdom. They're a tremendous blessing to come alongside me and to serve. And so I want to just, we want to just say thank you. We want to show appreciation. And I've got a thank you card there for you as well. And we just want to say thank you. We love you very, very much. And thank you for serving in this capacity. Can we give him a hand? Amen. I won't make you say anything unless you want to. Okay. All right. Thank you so, so much. One more person I'm going to ask to come. I'm going to ask James White to come and join me on the platform. I know we have two Jim Whites, don't we? So this gentleman right here, there we go. And come right up here and join me on the platform if you would. And also at last week's business meeting, James was voted in to serve a three-year term on our church board. And so we appreciate your willingness to serve. And I'm going to put you on the spot and ask you just to say something, but something very briefly. All right? I'm not giving you a long period of time. Just in about 10, 15 seconds. All right? I love giving him a hard time. Just greet the people, and as you serve in this capacity, just what's your heart for the church, and just say hello, because you've been here for several months, but folks are still getting a chance to know you as well. So just say hello to the people. Would you do that?
Hello to the people. But yes, I'm very honored that I'm up here. Very honored that I'm up here. And I tell you what, every board that we've been on, it's all about the youth, and it's all about growing, and it's all about, you know, doing the pastor's, you know, whatever he deems necessary. And, you know, the thing it is, it's wonderful. We're looking to grow. Like I say, I've been on several boards, and I tell tell you what, when you look at the future and stuff, right now, the only thing I want to do, I'm not going to talk. I'm just going to listen to the other board members and listen to our pastor and support him in every way that I can. And but it all starts with the people. It's not about the board members. It's all about the people, their wishes and their desires. And like I say, we need to support our pastor in any way that God leads him. And like I say, I could stay up here and tell you it all started at, you know, my parents, they did have drug problems. They drug me to church every time the doors opened. I'm a little boy. And, you know, like I say, I've been to different types of churches. We've mostly been Pentecostal. And I tell you what, my wife is the one that got me in this one. And I tell you what, I love this guy that's standing next to me. And believe it or not, even old guys like me, I mean, at 73, I still come to them with my problems. And I said, I've got all this hate in there for all these politicians that's out there. And he said, Brother Jim, what you need to do is pray for them, not chastise them. You need to pray for them. But, you know, regardless of how young or how old, we've always had really wonderful youth groups. And we did a lot of stuff for the Lord. In the ladies' ministries, I tell you what, they paved two parking lots for us in the past. We built churches. I've added steeples. We did roofs. We converted old warehouses into stuff. And the only thing I miss about the another church coming over with us there is I love that gym. I would love to see a gym. But it's not what I want. It's what you guys want, okay? And I'm nothing. I'm just here to support our pastor and get things done the way they should be done. You know, like I say, just pray for me.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, sir, so much. You went over 15 seconds, but I won't hold it against you. Hallelujah. I love God's church, and I love God's people. And it's a privilege, isn't it, to be a part of the body of Christ? Amen. And so, praise the Lord. Hey, at this time, we want to pray over our tithes and offerings this morning. And thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord and the work of the Lord. And can I say this as we prepare to give? We had a tremendous back-to-school festival yesterday. And Sherry heads that up. And Sherry and her team did a tremendous, tremendous job. And can we give them a hand? Amen. Countless hours that some of them spent preparing for yesterday. And one of the things that's just so great, and Sherry does a great job in leading that, is I don't ever have to worry about how's it going. I just show up and say, where do you need me to help? And that's always great, great, great to be able to do that. So we had, talk to me, Sherry. So yesterday, how many backpacks did we give away? 530-ish backpacks we gave away yesterday, and we had around 180 cars or so come through the drive-through, and so several of those cars obviously had multiple kids in them, and we got to be a blessing. We heard some great feedback from people as they came through. Of course, the event looked totally different this year because we had to do a drive-through event with everything that was going on, but we made the most of it. And it went really, really well. We had a great turnout. We had a really good response from the community. Got to bless a lot of people. And so all of you participated in so many different ways. And so we want to say thank you for your giving. Thank you for your praying. Thank you for your participating. Just in the last month, we've had two really, really powerful outreaches right here in our community. And so it's a privilege and a joy to be able to get out and to get into the community, and to do that, we're going to be doing more stuff this year along that line. So just be ready to continue to be involved. And because how many of you know we need to keep getting the gospel to people? Amen? It's all about Jesus. So let's pray over the tithes and offerings today as we prepare to give. Father, we thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you for the privilege that we have, Father, to give to you. And so we bring our tithes. We give our offerings, and because, God, we love you. It's an expression of our worship. It's an expression of our gratitude to you. Lord, it's an expression of how much we love you. Lord, we just read in Romans 8 how that you gave your Son for us. Lord, we can't give enough that truly expresses how thankful and grateful we are. And so, Lord, we don't give as a way to try to pay back what you've done to us, for us. Lord, we don't have a debt. Lord, we give just to say we love you and we say we thank you. And so, Lord, thank you for allowing us to sow into the work of your kingdom. Bless each and every one that's giving. In Jesus' name, amen. You can give digitally or there's an offering box as you leave today. You can give, but thank you for your giving. But let's worship the Lord with one more song. Amen.
You're the only answer to the darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. The voice that calls me on, louder than every rock. My sword in every fight, the truth will change away. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captive, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, you won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. Lord, it's written, hope is certain. Know that your word will never fail. Know that in every situation, speak the power to prevail. Louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will change away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captive, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. You won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. When you speak, you scatter darkness. Light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe a change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. When you speak, you scatter darkness. Light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe a change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captive, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, you won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. Your name is power.
Hallelujah. How many believe his name is power? Everybody say power. Hallelujah. We want to dismiss our children at this time, those ages 4th up through 6th grade. can be dismissed this morning. Hallelujah. God bless them. Praise the name of the Lord. Turn to your neighbor. Tell him you're glad to see him. Would you do that? Hallelujah. Thank you, gentlemen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We have been, the last couple weeks, we have been reviewing this "How well do you know your Bible?" quiz, test, whatever you want to call it. Several weeks ago, these were on the seats when you came in, and with 10 questions, it was entitled, "How well do you know the Bible?" And we didn't have you put your name on it, just to do it anonymously, and we took those and just getting the pulse of the church of how we're doing on some Bible doctrine knowledge. And so we've been reviewing each week, the last few weeks, a few of those questions so you can know how you did. Because some have been saying, "Pastor, how did I do? I want to know, did I get the right answers?" All right? So I'm going to give you the last few answers on this. Okay? Are you ready? So we're down to number seven. And the question was, this was a fill in the blank. The question was, what does Scripture mean when it says that all Scripture is inspired by God? And that, of course, is out of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Some newer translations literally translated all Scripture is God-breathed. Because that's literally what inspired means, God-breathed. And so, simply, Scripture is inspired, simply it is, it's God speaking to us. He led men what to write. Okay? He led, not that he put man in a trance, but the Spirit of God came upon man, led man what to write. And so over a period of at least 1,500 years, approximately 40 different people were involved in writing what we have today as the Holy Scriptures. Okay? And so when we say it's God-breathed or it's inspired by God, this is God speaking to us. And how many of you know there's no other book that's on the same level as this book? There's some other good books out there. I love to read. You love to read. There's some great books, but they're not God-inspired on the level that the Holy Scriptures are. And if you've been with us on Wednesday nights, we've been teaching a series entitled, "How Do You Know the Bible is True?" and other questions people have about the Bible. And we went into detail about some of these things. Number eight, the question was, who are the three persons of the Trinity? And they are God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And we see that Old Testament and New Testament, it's very clear you see evidence of the triune Godhead. Now, that doesn't mean there's three gods. How many know there's only one God? One God in three distinct persons. God, they're fully one. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Number nine, the multiple choice question was this. The omnipotence of God means that He is, and there were some options there, the correct answer is all-powerful. All right, that big word omnipotent means He's all-powerful. And I've told you this before. Here's how I remember it as a kid. I used to think that word was omnipotent. So if that helps you remember what it means, God's potent. He's powerful, right? So there you go. Omnipotence, though, is how it's pronounced. Omnipotent. He's all powerful. And the last question was the judgment for believers. How many know there will be a judgment for believers? One day, every person that's born again, there's still a judgment day coming for us. The judgment for believers is called, and there were a few answers to choose from. The correct answer is the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. One of the other answers was great white throne judgment. That is another judgment that will take place, that all of the wicked will stand before God, and those whose names are not found written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be cast into the lake of fire. But the judgment seat of Christ is the judgment for all believers. At that judgment, it's not going to be determined did I make heaven or not, because we'll already be there. But the Bible teaches we'll be judged according to were we faithful in serving God. Were we faithful in what God called us to do? And how many of you know that on the judgment seat of Christ, it talks about there will be rewards that will be handed out. And there will be disappointments. Because how many of you know that we need to be faithful to what God's called us to do and who God's called us to be? Amen? And so with God, yes, there is accountability. But the judgment seat of Christ is the judgment for believers. So there we go. We made it. It took us like 3 Sundays, but we made it through all 10 questions. And now you know how you did. If you have your Bibles, would you get them out this morning? And turn with me to 1 Peter. We're going to go this morning to 1 Peter. If you have your Bibles, say amen. Hallelujah. Those of you that are watching online, I want to encourage you to get your Bibles out with us this morning. Hallelujah. And we're going to go to 1 Peter. First Peter chapter 1. Say this with me. The Word of God is the wisdom of God. The Word of God is the will of God. And the Word of God is the revelation of God. Let's begin reading 1 Peter, and we're going to look at verses 1 and verses 2. And we're entitling today's message, Foreigners in a Strange Land. Foreigners in a strange land. And we're going to talk today a little bit from the Word of God about perspective. Everybody say perspective. How many of you know perspective is huge? Perspective will affect how you live. Perspective, of course, is a matter of how you look at something. How many of you know 2 people can look at the same thing but have a different perspective and therefore they approach it with a different attitude? How many of you know that's true? And so as we get into 1 Peter this morning, and we're going to mainly be looking in the first chapter today, we're going to see really that Peter is talking with the church and he's addressing the matter of perspective. The matter of perspective. But let's begin with verses 1 and 2. If you have your Bibles, make sure you follow along. He says this, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. So Peter's writing here, right? As an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with His blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. Notice there in verse 2, there it mentions the Trinity right there. The Father, Son, the Holy Spirit are mentioned right there in verse 2. But notice here, who's writing this letter? Peter is. Simon Peter. This is the Simon Peter we know that Jesus approached while he was fishing on the Sea of Galilee with his brother Andrew. And Jesus said, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. This is that Simon Peter. This is the Simon Peter that walked with Jesus. This is the Simon Peter that was a witness to Jesus dying and a witness to his resurrection. This is the Simon Peter who was a witness to the ascension of Christ. This is the Simon Peter that was one of the 120 on the day of Pentecost who was filled with the Holy Spirit. This is the Simon Peter that stood up, recorded in Acts 2 on the day of Pentecost, and preached the message, and people said, what must we do to be saved? So I want us to understand who we're talking about here. Peter now is writing some years later to believers. And it says here, he's writing to God's elect. He's writing to the church. He's writing to Christians, to followers of Christ. And he refers to them as exiles. In other words, he recognizes them, refers to them as a people that are living in a land that they're only passing through. An exile is somebody who's not currently living in their homeland. How many of you are with me? So he calls them exiles. These are people who are born again. They've been chosen of God. They're followers of Jesus Christ. Now I want you to drop down with me for a moment to verse 17. Keep your Bibles open because we're going to look at a few verses in this chapter. Look at verse 17 of 1 Peter chapter 1. He says, since you call on a father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners in reverent fear. Now look at that. He calls them what? Foreigners. Live out your time on this earth. He's saying your time here is temporary. You're only on this earth for a season. He says live out your time here as foreigners. I want to make this statement right off the bat. Every child of God, every person who is born again is a foreigner that's living in a land that's not your home. Turn to your neighbor and say, this earth is not your home. You're a foreigner. Right? You're a foreigner. Think about it. I want you to get that in your spirit this morning. This is the perspective I'm talking about. Peter is writing to the believers. He says, listen, don't get too comfortable. He says, you are a foreigner. You are an exile. You are only passing through. And that is a message to every single one of us as people of God. Earth is not our home. We are actually citizens of heaven. Did you know that? You say, well, I haven't got to heaven yet. No, we haven't got there yet, but how many know it's already our home? Do you realize that? We can already call heaven home. We are citizens of heaven. We are citizens of the kingdom of God. This is our temporary residence. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Our temporary residence. Actually, we'll put this, let me show you this in 1 Peter. In the second chapter, I'll put it on the screen, verse 11, Peter expounds on that. He says, dear friends, he says it again, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. So this is a theme throughout 1 Peter. He said, listen, you're foreigners. But Peter's not the only apostle, the only New Testament writer that wrote with this thought. Because Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, look what he says here. He says, Paul is writing to the church at Philippi, and he says something very similar. He says, but our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody say, eagerly await. How many of you know that this is supposed to be our attitude as believers? That we are eagerly waiting and anticipating. But here's what happens. Many times we get so caught up in the cares of the world that we lose sight of the fact that Jesus is coming. We lose sight of the fact that this is temporary. And so Peter, and that was the same case with, you know, and there in the first century in the New Testament, as Peter is writing to believers, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But he says, listen, Paul says, we are, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await. Have you ever eagerly awaited something? As a young child, remember eagerly awaiting Christmas? Right? You couldn't wait. Right? You counted down the days. Right? Maybe even as an adult, you eagerly await Christmas, right? I don't know. Or that vacation you have planned and you're going to leave on, and you're counting down the days, and you're eagerly awaiting. And guess what? Every single day, at some point, you think about it. You're planning it. You're preparing for it. You're anticipating. Paul said, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the same thought line is found in Hebrews 11, 13. In Hebrews 11, the chapter of faith, talking about saints of old, it says in verse 13, all of these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. Watch this. Admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. Listen, folks. It's a matter of perspective. We need to understand, as born-again believers, we are foreigners in a strange land. What does that mean? Well, let me tell you. As citizens in heaven, living in a temporary residence, that means we have a different set of values and customs than the world does. Right? We're citizens of another place. How many of you know, you go to different countries, they have different customs, different cultures. Well, guess what? As citizens of heaven who temporarily live here, our customs, our set of values are different than what the world has. As citizens of heaven, we respect and follow the laws of the land, but we live to a higher law, which are the laws of God. As citizens of heaven, even when the world gets away from following God's law, God's word, we continue to live according to it. Why? Because we're citizens of heaven. As citizens of heaven, even though the values and morals of the world may erode, the church should not slide with it because our standards are different because we live according to the standards and the values of home. How many of you are with me? As citizens of heaven, some of the things that are appealing to this world will not appeal to God's people because we're a citizen of heaven. We are only passing through and knowing that one day we're going to get home. We're going to get to heaven. We are foreigners. We're foreigners. Now, in your Bible there in 1 Peter, jump back up now to verse 3. Let's go up to verse 3. Look at it in your Bible with me, verse 3. And we're going to walk through a few verses here and see what happens when we have this perspective. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that for just a moment. What's Peter say? He starts, we have every reason to give God praise. How many of you know we have every reason to give God praise? And then he says this, in his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope. He's given us new birth. Jesus talked about that in John 3. He said, you must be born again. How many know you and I must be born again? Every single person that's here or that's watching online, understand the only way we make it to heaven is if we're born again. Without Jesus, we are separated from God. Sin separates us from God. We're slave to sin. We're bound. Sin is our master. But thanks be to God. We are born again when we confess our sin, when we repent or turn from sin, when we embrace and follow Jesus Christ. How many of you know at that moment we're forgiven, we're born again? We're born. You say, Pastor, what's that mean? It's not a natural birth, it's a spiritual birth. Our spirit man prior to knowing Jesus is dead. But when we are born again, spiritually we come alive. Our spirit man is made brand new. That's why the Apostle Paul said, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. And Peter says here, by his mercy, he's given us new birth into a living hope. I love that word hope. If there's something that people need today, it's hope. Everybody say hope. A lot of people feel hopeless. A lot of people feel like, is there hope? What's the, and that's why the enemy lies to people and say, it's not worth living. What's the hope? It's not worth going on. What's the purpose? What's the hope? Well, you know what Peter says here? We've been given us new birth into a living hope. Every person that's born again, that's a follower of Christ, has a living hope. What is that living hope? It's the hope of eternal life. It's the hope of knowing we have an expectation that Jesus is coming again. He's going to take me home. And the resurrection of Jesus guarantees a future resurrection. That's why that's a big deal. And so thank God we have a hope. The Bible refers to the return of Jesus for his church as the blessed hope. So my friend, we have hope. If the enemy's been lying to you, oh, there is no hope, you can say, no, as a child of God, I do have hope. My expectation is Jesus, one day, it could be today, He's going to come and He's snatching me out of here. And I don't need any more hope than that. Thank God for that. We have a living hope. Now look at verse 4. And this new birth into an inheritance that can never perish, never spoil, and never fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. So Peter expounds on it. What's that living hope? Well, he uses the word here, we have an inheritance. Remember, talking about a matter of perspective. Matter of perspective. That understand, okay, you know what? When I die, that's not the end of everything. I mean, you know, some people believe that. Some people believe that when you die, your body goes in the ground and that's it. It's all there is to it. Paul even talks about this in 1 Corinthians 15. If that's the end of all things, then there's no hope. What do we have to live for? But how many know that's not the end of it all? The body, the shell may go in the ground, but how many know we've just transitioned into eternity? We've just transitioned into a better place. We got to have the perspective that the saints in God's word had, that they understood. And so we see here this word inheritance, where Paul says we have an inheritance. We all know what an inheritance is. But why do we have this heavenly inheritance? Because we've been adopted. Thank God, when we're born again, Peter's reminding them, you've been adopted into the family of God. You have been adopted. God is your father. We are a son and daughter of God. And when you study scripture, especially, you go back and read the story of the prodigal son. And you learn that God teaches us everything that he has is ours. That's what he says to the older son. He said, listen. You've lived with me all this time, and everything that I have is yours. That's what God is saying to us. How many know everything he has is ours? Why? Because we are his son. We are his daughter. We have an inheritance. And he says one day, our salvation is going to be made complete. And we're going to reap that eternal inheritance in heaven. Now, how many of you know God has things for us even now? But one day, the ultimate reward is entering into glory for all eternity. Hallelujah. And I love what he says. This inheritance never perishes. It never spoils. It never fades. How many know you can inherit earthly things from somebody, and eventually one day you may end up spending all the money you inherited. Now it's gone. Or you inherited something material. It eventually wears out. It rusts. It spoils. It fades. It perishes. But how many know things that are of God are eternal? And we have an inheritance that nobody can take away from us. And it's saved, it's reserved in heaven for us. I like what Jesus said in John 14. Look at this verse. Remember this in verses 1, 2, and 3. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Now we could stop right there. And that's encouraging, isn't it? Do not. Jesus says to his followers, don't let your hearts be troubled. How many know it's possible to let our hearts be troubled? But they don't have to be if we don't let them become troubled. He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Well, how do we keep from our hearts being troubled? Keep the right perspective. Because then he says, you believe in God, believe also in me. He said, in my Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, he says, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? This is while Jesus was still walking on the earth. Verse 3, he says this, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and I'll take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Now, how many of you know where Jesus is right now? He's in glory. And how many of you know a place is being prepared? Amen. And he says, I'm preparing a place. I will come back. I will come back. How many believe he's coming back? Okay, let me ask you this. How many of we are living as if we believe he's coming back? Think about that. I will come back. And he said, I'll take you to be with me. that you also may be where I am. That's our inheritance. That's our living hope. All right, back to 1 Peter. Look at verse number 5. Look at verse number 5. Don't just read the Bible. Read the Bible. Study through and meditate what he's saying to us. Verse 5. Who through faith are shielded by God's power. As foreigners, what's it say? We're shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that's ready to be revealed in the last time. So while we're waiting to get to heaven, while we're living on this earth, what does he say? He said we are shielded. We are protected by God's power. I just told you a few moments ago from Romans 8, God is for us. How many know God's not against us? Amen? If that's Jesus, tell him hello. I like having fun with you. God's for us, not against us. And he says here, he shields us. Look at that verse, verse 5. I was reading that again this week and I thought, wow. Through faith, we are shielded by God's power. We have a promise of God's protective power. We're shielded. And that's a picture of like a military guard that watches on guard, watches out for danger, and keeps what he's guarding from danger. Now, how many know the enemy can try to come against us, but the enemy can't defeat us? Thank God for his mighty power. His mighty power. And that word power in ancient Greek was sometimes used to refer to the force of an entire army. And how many know God's power is greater than any other power? We're shielded. We're protected. The enemy cannot destroy a child of God. God is with us. He watches over us. And he will until we receive our heavenly inheritance. All right? Now let's look at the next verse. Look at verse number 6. How many of you are still with me this morning? Get ready because we're getting ready to shout. Look at verse. How many are ready to shout? Sometimes I just have to shout. All right? I was driving away from my house the other day and my daughter was with me. And we're driving off the parking lot, and I just let out a shout and scared her. She said, "What was that?" I said, "Sometimes you just got to let it out. You ever just feel better just sometimes just to let out a shout?" So don't shout at somebody. Let out a shout of praise unto God. I wasn't shouting at her. I just had to let out a shout. Look what this says in verse 6. He says, in all this. Now, if you read just verse 6, you won't get the full meaning of what he's saying. That's why I teach you, read the context. So, we read the first few verses, and now Paul says, in all this. Well, what's the all this? Well, he's saying, when you think about the fact that you're born again, in all this, when you think about the fact that you have a living hope that you will one day enjoy heaven for all eternity. Think about this. All of you watching online, listen to me very carefully. He said, in all this, when you think about the fact that you have an inheritance that is promised to you. Are you thinking about that? When you think about the fact that God protects you, he shields you by his power, and he will see that you get home. In all this, now look at verse 6. In all this, you greatly rejoice. In all this, you cannot truly ponder those things and not rejoice. You can't do it. If you truly ponder those things and believe it and know it's talking about you, you can't help but rejoice. If you don't rejoice, you don't truly believe it. You don't truly realize it's for you if it doesn't cause you to greatly rejoice. And when I studied that out, that phrase, greatly rejoice, literally means this. Getting so glad that one jumps in celebration. You say, "Pastor, I can't jump. I'm not going to ask you to." But that's what it means. It literally means getting so glad that you jump in celebration. You can't even express it in words. And that's the same phrase, literally what it speaks of in Acts 16. Remember the jailer who was saved, the great earthquake, and the prison doors open, and he goes into Paul and Silas, "What must I do?" And he leads him and his whole family was baptized that night. And in Acts 16, you'll see you'll see in Acts 16 that he was filled with joy because of his salvation. Literally speaks of getting so glad that one jumps in celebration. Peter says, in all of this, when you understand this, when you live with this perspective, you greatly rejoice. But read the rest of the verse. Verse 6. Though now, for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. Now, come on, can I ask, is there anybody here ever suffered some grief on this earth? We all have. Because we live in a broken world. We live in a sin-stained world. We don't live in a perfect world. We're not in heaven yet. So there's some grief. So he said, in all of this, you greatly rejoice. Though you've had to suffer for a little while. Everybody say a little while. You know what he's reminding you? It's temporary. It may seem like it's forever long, but in light of the grand scheme of things, life on this earth is very small and short in light of eternity. Somebody one time said this, I read in a book. They said, think of it this way. And it had a little picture. It had a dot. And from that dot, there was a line with an arrow. So the line just extended out for infinity. And he said, that dot, that little dot, represents our time on this earth. And he says that line represents, that goes on forever, that represents all of eternity. And it causes you to help to get perspective. So Peter says, though for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. Do we walk through trials? Yes. We don't lie to people and say, you know what, serve Jesus and you'll never have another trial. You'll never suffer any grief. Listen, we live in a sin-stained world. We live. Now, do I believe as people of God we can walk in victory? Absolutely. Anything we may face, God can help us to overcome. And I believe God can help us to walk in wisdom that maybe we can avoid some grief that sometimes we bring upon ourselves because of wrong choices. But there are grief. There is things that we walk through sometimes in this world. And he calls them all kinds of trials. They come in all shapes and all sizes and different names, but they're temporary. But the enemy wants to come at you. The enemy wants to try to destroy you. How many of you know God doesn't send these trials? Understand that. God doesn't send trials. That's not scriptural. But we know life throws things at us and the enemy comes against us. And he says, but in all of this, you greatly rejoice, even though you suffered grief in all kinds of trials. You know what he's saying? Even in the midst of suffering, you can greatly rejoice. That's foreign to the world. But it's a matter of perspective. Because what happens is, I don't just see the trial, I see the bigger picture. I see I'm coming through this thing. I see one day it'll be worth it all when I see Jesus. I see one day I'm going to get to a place where there's no more sorrow, no more tear, no more death, no more sickness, no more disease. And so when I think about that, I have every reason to greatly rejoice. Where are our eyes fixed? What is our perspective? Are we consumed with just what we see right around us? Or are we seeing the bigger picture and becoming consumed by how great God is and the hope that we have? Look at verse 7. He said, these have come, these trials, grief, they come at us, so that the proven genuineness of your faith, which is of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. You know what he says? Here's what trials do. God doesn't send problems. But you know what trials do when they come our way? They prove how true, real, or genuine our faith and our trust in God is. When everything's going great, it's easy to say, oh yeah, I trust God. How many know that faith is tested? It's proven. Do I really trust God when I'm walking through something? When the fire's turned up and I truly have to trust God, there's no other solution. It helps me to see, is my faith, is my trust really where it needs to be? So he's saying, listen, you can even utilize and allow these trials that come to help mold you and make you stronger and help us to see how we're really doing. Think about that. Now let's read on. Look at verse number 8. Verse 8. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are, now watch this, are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. So Peter, as he's talking about perspective, here he talks about rejoicing again. Even though you haven't seen him yet, you still love him. Right? He says, even though you don't see him now, you believe in him and you are filled. You're consumed. You're flooded, he says, with an inexpressible and glorious joy. The King James Version puts it this way, joy unspeakable and full of glory. Remember that song? It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. The half has never yet been told. You know what he's saying? You can't even utter in words the joy that you're feeling. He said words can't even describe. It cannot be communicated, the joy, adequately with words. That's why it means talking about jump for joy. You know, sometimes you get so excited, you just feel like jumping. Words don't even adequately describe how excited. Come on, have you ever been in a time where you were so excited you just couldn't help it? You just started leaping. You just started shouting. You see, sometimes you may come to church or you see somebody lifting their hands or jumping or dancing before the Lord and you say, why in the world would they do that? Let me tell you something. When you get a hold of the goodness of God, can I say this too? Don't ever criticize someone's praise because you may not know what they've walked through. You may not know what God brought them through. In Acts chapter 3, when the beggar was healed, it says he got up and he went into the temple walking and leaping and praising God. Well, how many know if you had never walked a day in your life and instantly you were healed, how many know you'd feel like walking and leaping and praising God and in celebrating God's goodness, he was doing what he had never been able to do before. And it would be easy for some to say, well, look at him. Can you see why in the world would he be jumping up and down? How many of you know, he says you're filled. When you have this perspective that we're talking about, he said to the believer, you are filled with an inexpressible joy. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. In other words, it's a joy that recognizes how glorious and great God is. Now this word joy, we're about done. This word joy literally means delight. Delight. You ever have anything in life that makes you happy? Happy, right? Biblical joy is not the same as just earthly happiness as we think about it. Biblical joy is a delight because happiness can be fickle, right? Some things make us happy and then something else happens. Now I'm no longer happy, right? Circumstances dictate it. Joy speaks of a supernatural delight in God. It's supernatural. Part of the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5. It's a supernatural delight in God. And so, one scholar put it this way. He said, joy speaks of a delight that comes from having an awareness of God's grace. Or to put it briefly, joy is grace recognized. When you have an awareness of God's grace and you live with an awareness, he's a good God, he's a giving God, he's a loving God, he's a grace and a merciful God. When you live every day recognizing God's grace, you're going to live filled with joy. Someone may say, how can you still be joyful and walking through a difficult time you're walking through? Because joy is not dictated by earthly circumstances. Our joy is because we're rejoicing in God. Our circumstances may change. God never changes. So even if you're walking through a trial, I can still rejoice in God. I'm not saying, oh yeah, thank you, Lord, for suffering. Woo, come on, God, send me some more grief. I'm not saying we're excited because we're walking through a trial. Our joy is in who He is, and He never changes. He never changes. So Peter says, live with the right perspective. Never lose sight of that you've been born into a living hope. You have an inheritance that will never spoil, fade, will never perish. You have the power of God who shields you and will make sure that you get home. You have all of this. And when you live with that perspective, it says you're filled with an inexpressible joy. Because you're keeping your focus on the grace of God. Can I tell you today, rejoicing should be our attitude even in the face of difficulties. This has been a year of challenges, hasn't it? It's been a year. All of us have walked through challenges, right? You've been trying to figure out as a family how to navigate through challenges we're facing in our world, right? We've had to walk and say, God, help us how to lead the church and pastor through this stuff. You've been how to lead my family through this stuff, your job, all of these challenges. But guess what? Through it all, we can rejoice and praise God. Through it all, we can thank God. You know what? I know whose I am. I know in who I am. I know where I'm going. And God, I thank you one day all this is going to be over, even if it means He's got to get me out of here for it to be over. We can be filled. Listen, let's not walk around full of doom, gloom, and despair. Are there things in our world going on right now that some of us probably don't like? Absolutely. And we could spend the rest of the day talking about things we don't like that's going on. You have your gripes. I have my gripes if we wanted to focus on them. But guess what? You know where I choose to put my focus? He's a good God. He's a good God. And as we walk through stuff, God, I'm going to make sure and keep my rejoicing on. I'm going to keep my praise on because I want to keep the right perspective. I want to walk full of joy. Now, here's a phrase. I wrote this down this week. If you remember nothing else, remember this. When we live, when you and I live with an eternal perspective, we will walk in joy. When you and I live with an eternal perspective, we will walk in joy. So the opposite of that is, if you don't live with an eternal perspective, you will not have joy. Not the joy God's designed for you to have. Think about that. Think about that. So in the middle of tough times, you can leap for joy. Right? You can leap for joy. And then I love, in closing, what it says in Nehemiah 8:10. Nehemiah 8:10. You know what it says? The joy of the Lord. It's your what? Strength. Anybody need some strength? Anybody wonder this year, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to make it through another week. I don't know how I'm going to make it through another day. Anybody wonder, Lord, I don't know how much more I can put up with all this stuff. Lord, I don't know how. Guess what? Here's one of the critical keys. Joy of the Lord is your strength. So I've showed you today from 1 Peter how to walk in joy. Have the right perspective. You've got to be serving Jesus and have the right perspective. And that'll give you strength. That'll help you get through each day because your focus is where it needs to be. Think about that this morning. We need to live with an eternal perspective. Keeping our eyes on the hope that we have. Don't become overwhelmed by current circumstances. Become overwhelmed by Him. Can we stand this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to pray. We're going to respond. If you're watching online, we want to encourage you to pray with us. We want to all respond to what the Holy Spirit is stirring in our hearts this morning. This whole idea of having an eternal perspective. Let's take this moment before we do anything else. Can we thank God for His Word? Come on, let's thank God for His Word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to pray in a moment. In a few moments, we're going to partake of communion. So if you're watching at home, you've got a few moments to grab some elements if you can, so you can join us for communion if you would like. But before we do anything else, let's just thank God for His Word. Hallelujah. Lord, we love You. Thank You for Your Word that is life. Thank You for Your Word that is encouraging, that helps us. Oh God. Oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank You, Lord. I thank You, Lord. Thank You for Your Word. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, as we're thanking God for His Word, as we're thanking God for His Word, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, would you call on Him? You can call on Him right now. If you're watching online, you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You say, Pastor Kevin, I don't know. I don't know that I'm on my way to heaven. I don't know that I am, because my life is not right with God. You can call on Him right now, right where you're at. Would you call on Him? Confess your sin before God, the Bible says. Repent of that. Make a decision to turn from sin. Say, starting this day, I'm saying yes to Jesus. Starting this day, I'm going to follow Jesus. Lord, I receive Your forgiveness. I call out to You. I need You as my Savior and my Lord. You're the only one who can save me of sin. You're the only one who can change my life. I surrender my life to You, Lord. Today, I say yes to You. You can do that right now if you mean it. Call on Him right now. If you're in this room or if you're watching online, call on Him right now. Don't wait another moment. Jesus could return today. Don't miss His return. Make sure you're living for Jesus. Make sure you're serving Him. Thank You, Lord, for salvation. Thank You, Lord, that we can be born again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank You, Jesus. We thank You, Jesus. Now, here's what I'm going to encourage us to do. In just a moment, we're going to lift our voice of praise unto God. We're going to lift our voice in thanking Jesus for the hope that we have. We're going to lift our voice in exuberant praise. Because when that's stirring in you, praise is something that has to be expressed and or demonstrated. Praise is something you got to release. And you thank God and you celebrate His goodness. An attitude of rejoicing. So if you're here today, you're born again. You're watching today, you're born again. You're aware of the fact you have a heavenly inheritance, a living hope. You're shielded by God's power. One day Jesus is going to come and take you home. If that's you right now, can we lift our voice and let's thank God for His goodness. Hallelujah! Come on, let's praise Him. Come on, let's praise Him. Come on, let's celebrate His goodness. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless You. We praise You. We honor You. We thank You. We celebrate You today. Hallelujah. Lord, we give You praise and glory and honor. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We celebrate You, Lord. We celebrate you. We celebrate you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah, I bless you. I bless you, I bless you. I give you praise. Hallelujah, I give you praise. The Bible says, put on a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. The spirit of heaviness. Because when we get consumed by the things of this world, there's a spirit of heaviness that can begin to come and rest on you. And it's heavy. And it weighs you down. Oh, but put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I'm going to encourage us all this week. Throughout your day, take praise breaks. Throughout your day, you start feeling down and overwhelmed. Turn off the news. Turn off the social media. And just start thinking about how good God is. Start thinking about your home. And start saying, thank you, God. I have hope in you. I'm rejoicing in the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God, we praise you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Quickly, if you're in this room, if you're in this room and you need special prayer, I want you to step out of your seat and come and stand at this altar. Would you do that? You say, Pastor, I need special prayer. I just feel to ask this. It doesn't matter, no matter what it is. We want to pray with you. We want to pray with you right now in Jesus' name. There's a need. There's something that you're facing that's weighing you down. It's heavy because it's something big that you're facing. And you say, I need prayer. I need prayer. Oh, I need prayer. I'm just going to give it to God. Just come. Just come. You can come and just spread out across the front. That's fine. Just come. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. Some of you, maybe it's just a spirit of heaviness that needs to be lifted. We're going to break that this morning in Jesus' name. It's a need that you have. We're going to believe God for a miracle and breakthrough in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Anyone else? You say, Pastor, would you just pray for me today? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you come to this altar, I want you just to begin to call on the Lord right now. Would you do that? Come on, just begin to call on the Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now we're going to come into agreement. And we're going to pray. And whatever it is that you're facing, whatever it is you're walking through, we're going to give it to God. And I'm praying this morning that you would become overwhelmed by His goodness. And that instead of being overwhelmed with what maybe you're walking through, you become overwhelmed with Him. The enemy would love for nothing else but you to become so discouraged, so overwhelmed, so distraught, whatever. The enemy would love to take you out. The enemy wants to steal your joy. You say today, I'm taking that joy back in Jesus' name. I'm going to pray for a fresh supply of the Holy Spirit, a fresh supply of the spirit of joy, the spirit of gladness, He's called, to flood your heart and life. And that when you leave this place today, you leave encouraged and refreshed in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, let's all come into agreement right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for those that have taken a step of faith. They've come to this altar. I pray, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I pray for these men and these women. I pray, God, right now, as we release and give that to you, as we give that burden to you, as we give that need to you, as we give it to you in Jesus' name, I pray, God, those that are carrying a spirit of heaviness, that as they praise you today, that would be broken off of their life in Jesus' name. I pray, God, a fresh supply of your spirit in their life. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, fill them with an inexpressible joy. Overwhelm them with your goodness. I pray for refreshing right now in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Lord, right now we call it done. Devil, you're defeated. Devil, you're a liar. Devil, you have lost. You have lost. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 In the mighty name of Jesus. Now I want you to encourage, if you're at this altar, would you just begin to thank God for meeting that need. Thank God for helping you. Thank God for lifting that. Thank God for helping it through. Thank God for overwhelming you with His goodness today. Hallelujah. Go ahead and praise Him for it. Hallelujah. Sorrow may last for a night, the Bible says, but joy comes in the morning. Joy comes in the morning. Our joy is found in you, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many know we serve a good God? Amen. I'm believing, those of you at this altar, I'm believing breakthrough, victory. And I want to encourage you just to continue to thank God even in advance for breakthrough and victory in Jesus' name. Because God loves you. God is for you, not against you. For you, not against you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Well, if you have those emblems, if you're at this altar, you can, if you want to find your way to your seat, that's fine. We're going to stay right in this attitude of prayer and worship, because this flows so powerfully what we're talking about. Dear, could you bring me mine, please? I think it's there on the seat, maybe. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. If you're at home, we encourage you, grab some juice and some bread and join us for communion. Hallelujah. If you peel back that top seal, there will be the wafer, and in a moment, the bottom seal will open up the juice. Everything we're talking about today is possible. How many of you know? Because Jesus gave His life. Amen. Jesus, the bread, represents the broken body of Jesus. The juice represents the shed blood of Jesus. That's why we have hope, because He paid the price with His life for us. How many of you know healing, salvation is found in Christ? How many know physical healing is also found in what Christ accomplished? Amen. Healing. Brother Carl, praying for you, brother. Healing is found in Jesus. As you go in for surgery this week, we're praying for for God just to minister, and we're believing for a good report in Jesus' name. So glad you're here today. Encouraged to see you. Love you. And I'm so thankful that Christ accomplished what he accomplished for us. Amen. And so whatever you need from the Lord today, he already provided. He already made a way. So Father, as we hold the bread in our hands, we thank you for giving of your life. By your stripes, we are healed. Your body was broken for us. And as you said, Lord Jesus, you said, do this in remembrance of me. We not only remember and say thank you, but we continue today to receive from you everything that you paid the price for and accomplished on Calvary. We thank you. Bless this bread. Let's partake of the bread, shall we? And Lord, as we hold the juice in our hands, that is a symbol of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for sending your Son. Every drop of blood that was shed for us counted. It's not wasted. Lord, the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And so, Lord, we thank you for forgiveness. We thank you. Lord, taking communion does not save us. We partake of communion once we're born again as a way to remember and to thank you. Lord, communion helps us to keep our eyes upon you. Helps us to keep the right perspective. Thank you for salvation and the hope that we have. Bless this juice, we pray. Let's partake of the juice as we remember. Hallelujah. Come on, let's thank the Lord. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Lord, we love you. Lord, we love you. Father, I do pray for Carl today. Thank you for your hand being upon him. We pray for healing and breakthrough in his life. Thank you, God, for your healing touch. We're believing, God, for a good report this week. In Jesus' mighty name, God, may he be encouraged in the presence of the Lord today. And God, I pray over all of your people. God, may we be encouraged with our eyes fixed on you. Father, we love you. Father, we thank you. Father, we bless you. And Lord, as your people, as they walk in obedience, Father, I pray your blessing over them. I pray, God, over those that are watching online. Father, I pray, may you bless them. Lord, may you be with them, help them. In Jesus' mighty name. I'm going to ask all of you to hold steady for just a moment. We want to dismiss our online audience. Thank you for joining us online. Let us know if we can pray with you in any way. We love you. God bless you. Hallelujah.